Sì. Is it okay, Stefano? Ah, 6-6.
3. Okay, so how to count configurations in the color nail is still possible. So you have that just to introduce a trick. Huh? And the trick is instead of counting as it happened in the long range, the swapping. Of course, now you have space, no? Because you have put local interaction. Local nearest neighbor interaction. So instead of counting that feature, you count the defects. Okay. So there are three objects on this model. It's plus pins, minus pins, and defects. Okay. Okay. So these are walls from minus to plus. Okay. So this is, for instance, a configuration with 12 plus pins, 8 minus pins, and U half is, so U is the number of antiferro bonds, is 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So now you have to move around the walls, the spins, and so on to count these states. Okay, now I give you the result, and then I will do on the blackboard the calculation. The result is that the volume at given number of plus spins, given number of minus spins, and given number of walls, of defects, is twice the combinatorial factor n plus over u half times combinatorial factor of n minus u half, okay? This is true, as you can see, approximately for large n plus, large n minus, and large u. Okay, and if you go to, but there is an exact expression that is not published in the paper, so it's worth that I give you to you. It's the first time that you have this. So moreover, in the paper, there is a wrong factor 2. So we don't put the 2 in the paper. That was a mistake. So I will do the calculation now for you for open boundary conditions. And you understand that this result depends on the boundary conditions, periodic, open, and so on. So I will do it for open boundary conditions. And for odd numbers of, these are the conditions. Let me try if I'm able to reproduce it, because I did it last night. So, okay. So I do it for u odd. And open boundary conditions. So if boundary conditions are open, suppose I have a string of, these are S. Of n spins, okay? And I choose the first spin with a plus, okay? So I choose the first plus. Then if I have an odd number of walls, for instance, 3, then if this is plus, this is minus, this is plus, this is minus, so it means that the n spin must be minus, okay, if I have an odd number of walls. Now, Okay. I number the walls, let's say K1, K2, and so on. And now I there are among the walls there are U minus one, because U is U minus one, because the last wall is here, over two walls that have plus pins there are to the right of plus pins. Okay? Did you get this? So you can try a longer configuration and you will convince yourself that you have U minus one half walls that are to the right of plus pins. And there are U minus one over two walls that are to the right of minus pins.
So in this case, U is equal to three, right?
Yes.
And you have two walls which are to the right of plus pins, no?
This and this.
Yes, there are two.
Two.
U minus one over two is one.
Because I don't count the last one, which is to the right of...
okay.
Okay. So, in fact, I have also to subtract n plus minus one. So I have to subtract one spin, one plus spins, okay? So the correct number is this, times n plus and minus minus one, u minus one over two, times two, because I can flip all the spins. And I get a new set of configurations. So the exact expression at finite n is 2 for open boundary conditions is 2 times n plus minus 1 over u minus 1 over 2 times n minus minus 1 u minus 1 over 2. Please check this, because it was in the large n, the ones goes away, and you get the expression that is on the blackboard.
So this assumes that you can rearrange the n plus.
So I can choose u minus. This is a way of choosing u minus one half walls among n plus minus one is a sorting of. U minus one over two walls over n plus minus one spins.
So you are choosing the u minus one over two spins who have a wall on the right.
On the right, yes. Okay. You have to do it yourself in order to convince that it is correct. Okay. In fact, the way we were reasoning for the in the paper was different, and then you can do it for closed boundary condition. Try closed boundary condition to see, and fixed boundary condition. And you will get different numbers, but in the large n, all of them will reduce to this, irrespective of the boundary conditions. Okay. So do for exercise both the closed boundary condition and the open boundary condition. I think you will have to convince yourself. So putting the pluses, maybe increasing the number of walls, and play with configurations to convince you that. If it is wrong, tell me, because already we published the wrong result, and I don't want to be wrong for the second time. So. So it was not so bad after all, because the factor here was okay. So log 2 over n, as Matteo was mentioning yesterday, is in the large n is 0, so there is no problem for everything. So So it was okay, finally. Okay, so you know that to do long-range interactions, in this case, you need to learn a little bit about combinatorics, a little bit more than what you learn in the usual courses on combinatorics. Okay, it's interesting. Okay, so what you get as an entropy, so now you express n plus and n minuses in terms of the total number of spins, in terms of the magnetization, and of the number of walls, and you get this expression for the entropy, where you see, I forgot to say that it is also a function of U. It's an intensive quantity because it's the number of walls divided by the number of spins. So I get this other entropy, again in the same class of previous entropies. And U, it's not, I don't see U, okay, now it's better. And U satisfies the equation for the energy. So the energy is minus J half M squared. This is the Curie-Weiss term, plus KU, the number of walls, okay? And so you can express U as a function of epsilon and M, and then you substitute, and then you maximize with respect to M, and you get the entropy as a function of energy. And you do the same, And the interesting part of the phase diagram is for K negative. For K positive, this was known also to Cardara and Nagel. For K positive, you have a second order phase transition line, okay? And the second order phase transition line in the canonical ensemble ends at the canonical tricritical point. And then you have a first order phase transition line which ends here. Similarly, as yesterday, you can compute this value exactly at zero temperature, comparing the paramagnetic to the ferromagnetic energy, okay? You can get exactly 0.5, minus 0.5.
Antiferro,
yes, it's antiferro. Sorry. The you compare the ferro with the antiferro, because here at zero temperature, you have the antiferro state. As soon as you increase the temperature, the antiferro state disappears. There is no antiferromagnetic order at finite temperature in one dimension. So as soon as you... This is different in two dimensions. For instance, Cardara and Nagel also studied the two-dimensional problem. By the way, it was the PhD of Cardara with Berker. He did this PhD with Berker. And, okay, so in fact, I knew this model because at that time I was interested in renormalization group and the effects of long-range interactions in the renormalization group, and I found this work by Cardara when he was a student in MIT, and I wrote a letter to him by saying I did an approximate renormalization group, and he replied to the letter, and he said, I did the exact solution. So, and I understood that Cardara was someone very strong. So I had an approximate method for some model for which he had an exact solution. So I remembered this after many years, and so I decided to study this model. Okay, we found the microcanonical solution. So you see that the shape of the phase diagram is very similar to the other one. It's amazingly similar, no? You have the microcanonical tricritical point which breaks into two lines of two temperatures, the upper temperature and the lower temperature. Here there is the temperature jump and the two lines join at zero temperature. So it's very similar. In fact, one could think, okay, you will find always the same. No. So there are other models. And the other good thing here is you see that here there is 0.6, 0.5, 0.4. It's no more restricted to that small area of numbers. So it's easier to study this model because the parameters are move order one when you vary the couplings, so you can get a better. Okay, so, and we could have done it for the other model also, but we did it for this. We realized that, you see that in these entropies, there are a lot of logarithms. And these logarithms should have a positive argument. And these put bounds on M, okay? So, clear, no? For given energy, given M, not all values of M are accessible, no? Because the argument of the logarithm should be positive, okay? Now you can see that just an example in this model is very simple. So suppose you take a positive magnetization state. So it means that the number of pluses should be larger than the number of minuses in order for magnetization to be positive. So you are on this side, okay? Then what is the maximum of the energy? The maximum of the energy, what is the maximum of the number of walls? There is a maximum for the number of walls. And it's when we put walls side of one of the two species, no? So at maximum, you can have twice the number of minuses as number of walls, okay? So if you rewrite twice the number of minuses as the total number of spins minus the magnetization, so you see that this is bounded by 1 minus the magnetization, okay? So this bound reflects into a bound in U, see minus magnetization, it cannot be negative, and it gives you a bound on M, fixed in epsilon. And if you compute all these bounds, the bounds in M fixing energy, you get this plot that is very artistic. So this is the line M equal below minus the square root of epsilon, so the maximum energy is zero, and the upper line is M less than minus square root of 2 epsilon that you get from this bound when U equals zero. And then these other bounds are bounds in M plus and M minus that result from this quadratic equation when you bring M on the left side, okay? So you see that in this model, the accessible states are not in a convex-shaped domain. These are the bounds for the states, and I can get them exactly. These are the bounds for the states in this model. And as I have said in the first talk, and this is the proof, the shape of the area of accessible states in systems that are non-additive can be non-convex. So in the Ising model, all these states are filled. There is a probability, a non-zero probability that these states are filled. While in this model, you will not found states here. Will not found states here. So in order to check this, I will go slightly faster. So we did a study of dynamics in this model using the Kreutz algorithm. Maybe if you want, I can say more about the Kreutz algorithm. Anyway, the idea of the algorithm is the following. It's a microcanonical algorithm, but there is a daemon in the game. And the daemon works this way. You try to swap a spin, and if the energy goes down, you don't accept the... If the energy goes down, you give the energy to the daemon. You give the excess energy to the daemon. You start the daemon with zero energy, so the daemon gets energy from the system. Okay? And if you need the energy to go up, you ask energy to the daemon. If the daemon has energy, You pick the energy from the daemon. So, this algorithm visits the energy shell for all energies that are below the energy that you had initially given to the system. But as the algorithm gets on, goes on, the number of energies of the system that are sampled are very close to the, if the system is large, the number of the energies that are sampled are very close to the limiting energy. So if you check during the time process which are the energies that are sampled in the system, they are very close to the microcanonical shell at the top energy. But it's also good if you sample energies below, because you know that the microcanonical shell only imposes that the energy is below a certain limit. And also, how can you extract the microcanonical temperature? You go and look at the... You cannot see it here, I don't know why. Maybe I eliminate. You go and look at the statistics if I go out, I cannot eliminate this black thing here. I don't know why. Yeah, okay. So if you check the statistics of the energy of the daemon, the statistics of the energy of the daemon is a Boltzmannian, but the constant is the microcanonical entropy. So it's is exponentially distributed, and the constant is the microcanonical energy. So you can get the microcanonical energy by taking the inverse of the average of the energy of the daemon. Okay? Because it's exponentially distributed. So it's a very good algorithm. It gives the microcanonical ensemble, and it gives access to the microcanonical temperature. So what we did with this algorithm, we ran the Kardar-Nagel model in a situation, for instance, where the entropy has this shape. There are three maxima, one in zero, and two are the maxima at positive and negative magnetization. And if you start here, which is this state here, you see that from time to time you have jumps to the other states. Okay? But suppose now you go to a region where there are non-accessible values of the magnetization. So you see that the entropy here disappears in nothing because there are no states here, which are these cuts that appear at given energies. And this is a similar cut. And you see, if I start here, I remain here. And if I start here, I remain here. There is no jump, because there are no intermediate states that I can jump to. Of course, I could do global moves. I could swap all the spins, okay? But with local moves, it will be impossible to move from one state to the other. So if you do also Langevin dynamics, it will be the same. So this is a breaking over godicity, so the phase space is broken. And this breaking over godicity is not the usual breaking over godicity which appears in the canonical ensemble or in other systems. It's due simply to the fact that there are some states that are not accessible to the system. So you cannot go to those states because they don't appear. And they are, of course, if you are in the canonical ensemble, since you have intermediate states, you can jump even with very small probability. But in this case, the probability of jump is zero. Okay, so what's next? I think you can easily program this is something that you could do. Try to write a code for the Kreutz algorithm. It's not very hard. And okay, what happens when it is possible to jump from one state to the other? So there is a barrier of a height delta. Then what happens is that if you are in the canonical ensemble and the interaction is mean field, the time to jump is exponential n times the energy barrier. And in the microcanonical, it's exponential n times the entropy barrier. This is to be compared with the jump in d dimensions, which is d minus 1 over d. This is the scaling of the So we tried this for the model, and you see that the lifetime, this is the exponential increase of the lifetime with n, and this instead is the logarithmic increase of the lifetime when there is no barrier, so when the system goes from one state to the other and is, so if there is no barrier, there is a logarithmic increase. If there is a barrier, there is an exponential increase. You can, maybe it's too much, but okay. I just want to tell you that we have a theory that, since it's unusual, we have a theory that explains this log n, which is based on a Fokker-Planck equation for the probability of the magnetization. And the theory, you can solve this equation, and the theory is based on the physical ingredient is the fact that the diffusion constant in long range goes down like 1 over n. So it's the diffusion in long range system is smaller and smaller as the size of the system increases. Because the mean field sort of freezes the system. And if you assume this, it's a very natural assumption, you can solve this equation, and you get this solution at time t. And if you fix the time to reach something of order 1, you get the logarithm of n. So, which is a direct, this log n is here because there is a diffusion that goes like 1 over n. So this is another feature of long-range systems, that the motion is diffusive of the single particle, but the diffusion constant is smaller and smaller as you increase the system size. And if you assume this, you get this log n for the evolution in the case in which there is no barrier. Okay, so this is was an additional comment. I don't know how many slides I have, but... okay. So this is, I put these slides just to help you in solving these models. So I did it for the Q-Revise. So in order to solve the two models in the canonical, I told you that you have to do the Q-Revise, the Huber-Stratonovich transformation. So I put it here for those who don't know how to do it. Okay. This is the square. Okay, this is the Q-Revise square. I use this integral, it's the inverse Gaussian integral, to rewrite it as an integral over x, okay? And then you get the free energy, and then you have to minimize over x, and you get the free energy as a function of beta. If there are other terms, okay, it's easy to find, but in this slide you find all the what you need to do the transformation that brings you to the canonical solutions of the two models that I've introduced, both the Blume-Capell and the so and X is this what is called auxiliary field, and you see that you have to solve it for you have to take the minimum if you want on the auxiliary field if you want the free energy.
So there is a question on Zoom. Mm-hmm. Someone asked, what is the value when you could say something more about how you get the Fokker-Planck equation? I think it refers to the previous slide.
Yes, it would take some time to derive the Fokker-Planck equation.
Do you assume Glauber dynamics?
Or yes, yes, uh-huh. yes. Okay. Assuming Glauber dynamics, and you can get the Fokker-Planck equation for all macroscopic quantities, also energy, for instance. You start from, for instance, you start from the n-body probability distribution function, and then you have a mean field, so you go to, can go to the single body, and then you have an equation, or a consistency equation for the field. There is a way of getting it. It's not simple, but okay. Yes, I have already marked to put the paper on classification because someone asked about these invisible things. Mm-hmm. Also, I will put the paper on azeotropy, if someone is curious, of this strange type of phase transition. And I can put two papers, one on the ensemble in equivalence, which is a 2001 paper with David Duhamel, and the other one again with David Duhamel, 2005, on the Kardar-Nagel model. So I don't want to invade the Slack with papers. Yeah, just references. Okay, just references, and then you have access to the library. Okay, so I would like just in the last few minutes, and then I stop, just because I think you are. Okay, just to introduce the method, it's an interesting problem in non-concave functions. So the question is, the point is the following. Suppose you have a partition sum that can be expressed as a function of x. X could be the Hubbard-Stathanovich auxiliary field, could be other things. Anything. So suppose you know that the partition sum is this, okay? So usually you know it because you have the Hubbard-Stathanovich, okay? Suppose you have other methods that give you the partition function in this form. And u is a differentiable function of beta and x, and x is some dummy variable, okay? Then, of course, the massive potential, which is beta times the free energy, is the inf over x of u, okay? Now, let us introduce the Legendre-Fenchel transform of u, okay? Which is the inf over beta of beta epsilon u beta x, okay? So it's a function of epsilon and x, okay? Then the statement of the theorem, I have a proof of this theorem, but it's not rigorous, and I think it's one, some mathematician should prove it. So suppose I take the sup of S, then I get the sup of X. So the inf gives me a function of x. And then I take the sup of x. The sup of x is the microcanonical energy, entropy, while if I invert the two, so I take the sup of x, and then I take the inf of beta, I get the canonical. So I get the Legendre-Fenchel transform of the free energy. So this shows that if you can give more freedom to the function S in order to explore different values of this dummy variable, you can, by inverting the sup with the inf, you can get the microcanonical entropy. So I will show tomorrow some examples. although it's limited, but it goes in the right direction, which is the one forbidden by Kherson Wang, of solving models in the microcanonical ensemble. So there is a wide class of partition sums for which you could get the microcanonical entropy by inverting the maximization problem. And as you know, inverting a maximization does not give the same result, okay? And in particular, you know that if there is a convexity in the entropy, the canonical entropy is always larger than the microcanonical entropy. So indeed, there is a relation that if you invert supem if, there is an order. Sup inf is less than inf sup. I will prove it tomorrow, also this inequality, okay? It's a two lines proof. Proving that this is the microcanonical entropy is harder. You have to work with, at least the proof that I know, as you have to work with the Laplace representation of the delta, and then to have to do, okay, you have to do, to argue. I will try to give a simple idea of how we believe, why we believe that this is the microcanonical entropy. And, but I think, for instance, one should prove it with large deviations. I think that there should be some proof using Cramer or Sanoff or some other theorems from large deviations. It is, of course, restricted to a specific class of cases. But I will show that there are plenty of them, and it's interesting. You get other forms of entropies, and you don't have to count. That's very important because, so for instance, with this trick, you can solve models with continuous variables, and you can get the microcanonical entropy for such models with continuous variables. Okay, so tomorrow I will give a proof of that, and I will show applications to class of models that have this feature. Okay.
Thank you very much.